Mr. Wright, I've heard you say many provocative things about the other arts. What have you been reading, or what music have you been listening to? What paintings do you look at?
All of them that are available, good and bad, because they're all features of architecture. They're all the arts are subject to the mother art, which is architecture. And when architecture was supreme, before it became moribund, they all belonged to architecture and were handmaidens of that great house. And when architecture ceased to be creative, became moribund, all these minor arts, as I call them, painting, sculpture, music even, although music and architecture are greatly parallel, same kind of mind, almost the same technique on a unit system. All those began to take a little shovelful of coals and start out on them on their own, you know, to do their own way. And they've never flourished much since. In architecture, of course, we haven't had. And it's all a sort of a pitiful wreck of a great, what was once a great household is now scattered and growing more and more helpless until architecture comes back again.
Mr. Wright, women have excelled in such arts as writing and painting and sculpture. Why do you suppose we haven't had women composers or architects?
I don't know about women composers. You mean in music? Mm-hmm. And painters, they've been some good women painters and good women composers. And no architects, because architecture is a pretty tough job. It's comprehensive, and you have to get your hands in the mud of which the bricks are made. And it's a pretty tough performance all down the line. I've always said that it was pretty difficult to be a gentleman and an architect at the same time. So I suppose that would be true of a lady, only more so.
Could we elaborate a little bit on this parallel between music and architecture in society?
Yes, I've always felt my father taught me. He was a preacher, but he was first of all a musician and made his living, or tried to, teaching music later on. He never was able to support us by way of it, and his life was a kind of tragedy. But he taught me that a symphony was an edifice of sound, and that it was built, and I learned pretty soon that it was built by the same kind of mind in much the same way that a building is built. And when that came to me, I used to sit and listen to the only master that was immaculate in my listening was Beethoven. He was a great architect, and he had a great disciple, and his greatest disciple was Brahms. Brahms was a true disciple, such as any man could be proud to have. If I had in architecture a disciple such as Brahms was, where Beethoven was concerned, I should be extremely happy. And perhaps I will have someday, but the two minds are quite similar because they arrange and build, conceive, develop, plot and plan in very much the same way. And both are working on a unit system, you see. There's the scale, the clef, and all the things that go in the notes on the scale, very like the thing an architect like myself does when he sits down to design a building. It's all on a unit system. You'll see little squares ruled all over the paper. And it all holds, the unit system holds the whole concept together in scale, so that one part isn't coarse and another part fine, and you'd have great difficulty but for the practice of the unit system and having a perfect synthesis of proportion. And that ensures the proportion of the thing. So there's a great sympathy between music and architecture.
Mr. Wright, your Unity Temple built more than half a century ago. is now a landmark in the architecture of the world. What would you say you achieved in it?
I think that was about the first time when the interior space began to come through as the reality of the building. When you sat in the temple, you were sitting under a big concrete slab that let your eye go out into the clouds on four sides. Then there were no walls with holes in them. You'll notice that features were arranged against that interior space, allowing a sense of it to come to the beholder wherever he happened to be. And I'd been working on that thesis for a long time, because it was dawning on me then, when I built that building, as later in the Hillside Home School, or about the same time, I guess, for my aunts, that the reality of the building did not consist in the walls and in the roof, but in this space within to be lived in. And that was a new countenance that a building should wear. And I was determined at that time to make that the countenance of the building, the interior space within.
How about the Robey House of 1909? Why do you think that house so powerfully influenced the design of dwellings everywhere?
Well, of course, it's hard to say. Again, the principle was working there, and the house had an atmosphere that belonged to the prairie, and it was more human than most of the things around. The Germans referred to it as dampfer architecture, steamboat architecture. It was an entirely new proportion in building, and it seemed to excite them and interest them abroad, even more than at home, although at home they had a great curiosity, and they'd come in droves on a Sunday around that house and other houses I was building. They had seen something new, something fresh.
Well, then came the beautiful house you call La Miniatura for Alice Millard back in 1923, I believe.
It opened the one in the ravine with some water in it that nobody dreamed could be built on, and it was for sale for $3,500 when the lots around were costing five times as much. So we bought it and built the house down in the ravine, and that was the first concrete block house, the first Usonian system house. I built five in Los Angeles altogether, but this was the experimental first one, and I couldn't get a permit to build it. I went to headquarters, and we had started building, and we had been stopped. So I went to the head of the building department, Backus, for a permit to build a house. And I took him out to see the house as a preliminary, and he looked it over, and he said, "Mr. Wright, this is the best thing structurally that ever came into this region." "Well," then I said, "I'm going to get a permit to build a house, am I not?" "Well, now," he said, "Mr. Wright, that's quite another matter. You know, there are the brick men, and there are the lumber interests, and there are all these interests. And if you were to go up for a permit, you'd have them all as a controversy concerning it." "Well," then I said, "where do I stand? What shall I do?" And he thought a minute. He said, "Go ahead and build it." So I built five others. There was a man who didn't think too heavily of the laws that had been made contrary to the interests of the human being. There are not very many such. The codes are adamant and at least 15 or 20 years old and entirely contrary to the interest of the man who wants to build a building.
Mr. Wright, your phrase organic architecture has become a part of the language by now, even if it isn't yet really comprehended. You've often called it a natural architecture, an architecture of integrity. Could you define it further?
Well, that word integrity you've just used is what is lacking in almost all artistic expression or expression of the arts today. And integrity would imply natural, would imply nature in a profound sense. And when you proceed from generals to particulars, as you do when you are building, that's your natural gut. Natural center line of your effort would be the what is the natural thing? What is the nature of your materials? Even the nature of your client? The nature of the situation on which the house is built? Nature of the climate? It's all a nature study, the building of a house. And I suppose it would be the same in a great composition like Beethoven's Erwacha, when he was celebrating the heroism of Napoleon. And then toward the end of his effort, began to feel that Napoleon, after all, was dead so far as his ideal was concerned, and a great sense of tragedy overcame him, and you feel it in the music. It's a great story, a great revelation of a man's worship and disillusionment.
I was going to ask you about some closer parallels between contemporary music and contemporary culture and contemporary architecture.
Well, the difficulty with contemporary music is that architecture is in possession of entirely new mediums, entirely new materials, an entirely new way of life, you see. Architecture was compelled to be new if it was going to exist. But no such thing has happened to music. You see, music, the orchestra, is still new. It's modern. All musical instruments that we have today are the same. So the musician has not been gifted, as the architect has been gifted with the means to a new expression. And they have only perhaps a vernacular which they can use to express themselves when they wish to be what they call modern. Now, modern is not necessarily new. Anything built today, no matter what its character or complexion, would be considered modern, but not necessarily new. But if it was new, it would certainly be modern.
Mr. Wright, I suppose that Falling Water, built in Pennsylvania in 1936, must by now be the most famous house in the world. What is the nature of that house?
30 million people must have seen Falling Water by now. Perhaps the whole world has seen it. I guess it has. Mm-hmm. But it was a very simple expression of a man's love for that particular sight, the music of the waterfall. And never before had I been given concrete and steel to build a building with. You see, when steel comes into your hand, you can pull on the building and you have what's called a cantilever. Now, the cantilever is this principle of tension. Your arm reaching out from your body and held by the sinews and muscles above, moving as you wish to move it as a cantilever. The trunk, of course, is the support that's in compression. But you can suspend from the end of the cantilever fabrications of any kind. So the new principle in architecture is this principle of the interior support, the extended slab, the arm, and the falling screen hanging to the slab. Now that's the structural synthesis of my own building. And it is essentially organic in itself. And that is Falling Water in principle. And the grammar of Falling Water, now we call the grammar of the building, the shapely means you use to make the building manifest. That was all a new grammar because it had neither coping nor base course. It was extremely simple, rounded edges above and rounded edges below, and slab surfaces, which had characterized the work always. In fact, Falling Water is no different from the work that preceded it in general design and effect, except for the details that go with steel and concrete. You can compare it with several houses that preceded it and see the same thing, except for the top edges and the bottom edges.
Mr. Wright, what are your first considerations in undertaking to design a house?
The nature of the site, like falling water. And next, the nature of the materials you have to use and the people you're going to work for and what it is they want to live in. And you have to have an eye on what they want to live for, too. I can't see any future in anything but an individual type of architecture. If the Declaration of Independence in America means anything, and democratic life means anything, that's practically what it means. You see, I was at Tullius in my country home, lying on the bench, the Dutch door half closed below. Great curiosity existed. It was during a tragedy at Taliesin, and people came in droves to look around, and two women ranged up on a Sunday morning, looked all around into the living room, and old and odd, and how beautiful this was, and how that was so interesting. Then a pause. Finally, one of them said to the other, "Well, I wonder if I'd like living in a place like this as much as I'd like living in a regular home." Well, now, that's the way it all began. These things were strange. They weren't accustomed. They were accustomed to stuffiness and a messy environment and things never going together, making a kind of commotion. And they didn't understand it and didn't want to understand it. They put it on like some old garment when they built a house without thinking. But now comes the necessity for not just taste, but some knowledge. You have to know now, a little better and a little further along, what constitutes good proportion, harmony in building, great and beautiful environment. And it's a culture and a growth in itself of the soul. So the people who live in these advanced houses, I think that's what we can call them, must have a greater feeling for life. They must be more in themselves than the people who haven't arrived at that stage in their development. And once they have arrived there, they are liberated, they feel, and they see so much more than they ever saw before. They see the lineaments of nature, and as Blake would put it, the lineaments of gratified desire. And they write thankful letters, and they're really sometimes very touching. And now when we don't want to build houses anymore, I can't get out of building them because people write and say, "Dear Mr. Wright, ever since I was 16 years old, I have wanted a house designed by you." Now that's the way it begins, and before it ends, you're building another house, that's all. But that's the way it is now. We're so much engaged in building important things like new theater, and new type of museum. We call it the Arcoseum, to explain to people that it isn't just another museum. And the Monona Terrace project in Madison, a civic center, and a great factory and administration building in California, and a score of other things, you know, that are new and compelling. And to do houses at all is a terrible drain, because it takes as much to build a house as it would to build $1 million building, almost, or at least $500,000 building. So an architect like myself now is very much like a doctor who will do the things that are essential without profit and charge the profit up to his influential patients. So if we get a big building to build now, we can build small buildings. But it's conditioned on that, I guess.
I wanted to ask something about the other forces in contemporary architecture and contemporary furniture, and now the people who live in these other houses.
But I didn't say new houses. I said organic houses.
you see a modern young couple in one of these very violently severe modern places, with, and they seem completely at home. They're completely comfortable, this kind of thing.
Now, well, they're making a heroic effort. And they are like goldfish, as a rule, in a globe. And these houses that are so classified as they now are, they're not sensible. It's an abuse of privilege and an abuse of material. And those things always follow in the line of any new movement. Now, this architectural this desire for an architecture that is more expressive of human culture than the ones we've been having always has its soiled fringe. Every such movement will have its extremists, will have its abusers, will have its exploiters, and that has happened, of course. Now, you can't expect the average man or woman who wants to build a house to know the difference. Something inside them has to tell them what is good and what's bad, because they don't yet know. But someday they're going to learn about it in school. And that, I believe, is what's happening now, as we said a little while ago. I believe now people are going to know what constitutes good architecture, good environment, and, of course, good living has to go with it. Good dressing, too. Good conduct, also. All these good things are dependent, more or less, one on the other, and are assisting one another, more or less. Because you wouldn't dress in a loud and vulgar way in a quiet and beautiful room. Nor would you be so satisfied with tawdry jazz, perhaps, in a room that was beautifully conceived and had a lovely atmosphere and belonged where it was. It would seem more than ever discordant. So these things all match up as you go along and add up to something that we call culture. Isn't that it? That's what culture means. Now, culture and education are two very different things as we practice them. Culture is the developing of the thing by way of itself. And education is informing, teaching, telling, pushing around the individual. So it's only by a natural growth that you can attain culture, which you can come back from a school all filled with stuffed with ideas and what we call conditioned instead of enlightened. Isn't that so? So education today doesn't mean culture. In fact, my old master Louis Sullivan used to declare that an eyebrow is a man educated far beyond his capacity. I mean a highbrow. Was a man educated far beyond his capacity. And today I think all these youngsters are educated far beyond their capacity and not cultured at all. So I say that education today is not even on speaking terms of what we should call culture. And we need culture more and education less.
How do we get it?
We get it by such effort, I think, as this thing we're talking about. An organic architecture, a new sense of what constitutes humanity under harmonious conditions. A harmonious place in which to live and a harmonious way to live in it. And it is greatly influential where all these various factors in human living are concerned. There's a tremendous, what do you call it, not kickback, that's not a good word, but reflection. What would you call it, Ben?
In a boomerang?
No, it doesn't come back that way. It's something that has a continuous pressure and influence on you toward harmony and the good.
The consequence?
Well, there is a word, of course, for everything. But you don't come by it every time.